So in this video, I would like to introduce both the benchtop multimeter and also the handheld multimeter. And the first thing you might notice about these is that obviously the benchtop multimeter is a lot bigger. It's also more expensive. Let me explain why. A closer look here at the benchtop multimeter. It has quite a lot of buttons on it, and it also has a lot of labels on it. You see, to measure some things like voltage or resistance, you have to plug the cables into different ports than, say, if you were going to measure something like current. So that's the first thing to be careful about. Some of these labels that you might see on the meter are as follows. These two lines here mean that we want to measure DC voltage or DC current. This wavy line means that we want to measure AC voltage or AC current. This omega symbol means that we would like to measure resistance or ohms. This is a continuity check. And the other buttons are related to the setup of the machine. Right now, we've got the red cable plugged in here to do a voltage or a resistance measurement, and the black cable here is plugged into the other port that we would need. So we have it completely ready. Let's now look at the smaller multimeter. This one's cheaper. It's not as good. And let's look at some of the symbols on this machine. So right now it's turned off. Again, we have, in this case, three different ports. One is called COM, or the common port. And right now the red cable is plugged in to either a voltage, resistance, or a current measurement. And it's important to notice here that for the current measurement, it says that it's 400 milliamp max fused, which means that if you're measuring current, and the current reading is more than 400 milliamps, it's going to blow out a fuse inside the machine. It's very important to be careful about these current ratings for the machines or the multimeters as you're using them. For this other port, if I were to measure current here, it says it's 10 amps max. So you can obviously measure a lot more current if you have the leads situated like this than if they're situated like this, but obviously this one would give you a more precise measurement if the current value is not very high. Again, we see a lot of the same symbols on the small multimeter that we see on the benchtop meter. We see DC voltage, AC voltage, resistance or ohms, a continuity check just to see if something's connected or not, microamps, milliamps, and amperes. It also has a HFE, which is a measurement of gain in a transistor, but that would be a subject for later. So now let's draw out some of the typical ways that you might connect up one of these meters to a circuit in order to measure voltage or current in the correct way. All right, let's say that you have a circuit that's been set up with the DC power supply and you want to do some measurements on it. Particularly, you would like to measure current and voltage using either the handheld multimeter or the benchtop multimeter. Let's go ahead and draw the circuit. One very simple circuit would be a 10 ohm resistor. And let's say that you've got the power supply set hypothetically to 10 volts. Now, how would you do a voltage measurement? Well, one way to do a voltage measurement would be to hook up the voltmeter like this. I want to change my pin color here because voltmeters have both red and black connections. If you had the voltmeter set up like this, the voltmeter would display a positive 10 volt because the red line on the voltmeter is aligned with the positive output pin of the DC power supply. And if the power supply is turned on, there's going to be 10 volts across the resistor and the voltmeter would register positive 10 volts. But hypothetically, what would happen if we were to switch the directions of the cables? What would happen if we were instead here to hook red on one side and black on the other? It would still work, but the voltmeter would now read a negative 10 volts, right? And I think the difference is probably clear in this case. Now let's consider what distinguishes a good voltmeter from a bad voltmeter. All right, well, a good voltmeter is one that doesn't interfere with the voltage that it's trying to measure. And if we look at this circuit diagram, what does it mean for the voltmeter to not affect the circuit that it's trying to measure? And to do that, let's consider the current that's coming out of the power supply and where that current normally goes. You see, when the voltmeter is not connected, all of that current, 100% of it, goes through the resistor and back into the DC power supply. However, if a voltmeter is attached, a tiny little bit of that current will have to be diverted into the voltmeter in order for the voltmeter to have something to make the measurement with. But you see, that tiny bit of current that's diverted into the voltmeter will affect the voltage drop across the resistor. In other words, the voltmeter behaves as if it's a small resistor. So I can now make a little circuit model of a voltmeter. So here's my voltmeter. And I could represent this mathematically as a small resistor. And when I say small here, I just mean that I've drawn it small. Because in fact, a good voltmeter is one with a very, very large resistance. So an ideal voltmeter, of course, has an infinite resistance. Because if the resistance looking into a voltmeter is infinite, then there won't be any current flowing through it. So ideally, the resistance of a voltmeter is high. And this is really what distinguishes a bad voltmeter from a good voltmeter, and it's also the distinguishing feature of these small, cheap, handheld voltmeters that you might find from the more expensive benchtop multimeters that we have in our labs, for instance. All right, now let's go on to the situation with current. So in the normal situation, current flows out of the power supply and around the circuit. And how would we measure that current? You see, current is a lot like water flowing through a pipe. You have to have some kind of meter in the pipe in order to see how much water is flowing. So what we need to do if we're going to measure the current is to insert something into the pipe or insert something along the path of the current in order to measure what the flow rate is. So measuring a current is fundamentally different than measuring voltage. So let's break the circuit path and insert something. And what we're going to insert here is the ammeter, a device that can measure current. And just like the voltmeter, it typically has red and black leads on it. And these are just related to the polarity. And let's assume that we have the same situation, a 10 volt DC power supply, a 10 ohm resistor, and an ammeter connected with the polarity as shown. All of the current will be diverted around the loop through the ammeter and back out through the resistor. And the ammeter will tell us how much current is flowing. In this situation, we can use Ohm's law, V equals IR, so it should display 1 ampere of current. And if I were to swap the red and the black leads of the ammeter, it would then display -1 ampere. It would still work, right? But the red and the black indicate the polarity to show you which direction the current is actually flowing. Now let's talk about what makes a good ammeter and a bad ammeter. Well, obviously, we don't want the ammeter to have infinite resistance like we did with the voltmeter. Because you can see in this diagram, if the ammeter had infinite resistance, then it would block all of the current. And that wouldn't be a very good thing when we're trying to measure the current. So, in fact, we want the opposite situation with an ammeter. We want the resistance to be zero. So let's now make a little model, a mathematical model of an ammeter. And we could again model an ammeter as a little resistor because it does have to have a little bit of voltage drop in order to measure the current. In other words, if you're trying to measure the flow of water through a pipe, you do have to block a little bit of that flow, otherwise it's impossible to know how much water is flowing. It's the same thing with a circuit. However, ideally, the internal resistance of an ammeter would be 0 ohms. Realistically, it's a number that's slightly higher than 0 ohms. All right, and this is really the distinguishing feature of the large, more expensive benchtop multimeters that we have when we compare them to the small handheld multimeters that we have. The benchtop multimeters have a smaller input resistance, or as we normally say, it has a smaller input impedance than the large, than the small handheld multimeters, right? So the benchtop meters tend to be better. Now, there's one more thing that I want to point out before we go back over to the bench and do some measurements, and that is the following. it's possible to do something rather dangerous, or at least not good for the ammeter, if the measurement is not set up correctly. And this is the following. If somebody were to naively set up the circuit without the ammeter connected, and then they thought, for example, well, I want to measure current, and they didn't measure it correctly. They thought, well, let me just hook it up like the way I would measure voltage. What if we hooked it up like that? What would happen? Because quite often at the beginning, maybe some students would get voltage and current confused, or they might forget that they need to break the path of the circuit in order to measure current. What would happen if a student wanted to measure the current flowing through the 10 ohm resistor, but accidentally hooked up the ammeter the wrong way? Well, because an ammeter ideally has a very small input impedance, then the path of the current around this loop is actually a much lower resistance path than the path of the current through our 10 ohm resistor. In fact, if we have 10 volts applied across a very small resistor, then the power is going to be very high. Let's write the equation for power. Power equals V squared over R. So as the resistance drops, the power dissipated increases. So if we have an ammeter with a very, very low input resistance, then the power it would dissipate at a given voltage would be high. And that's exactly the problem and why fuses often get blown in ammeters. Because if an ammeter is hooked up incorrectly, directly to a DC power supply, then an ammeter has to dissipate a huge amount of power. And in a practical situation, it just blows a fuse inside the ammeter. And that usually isn't a very good thing, right? So we usually try to avoid that. All right, so I'm going to go ahead and hook up the 10 ohm resistor that we saw in the first video, and let's measure voltage and current going through this resistor. So to start off with, let's turn everything down so that we don't have any unanticipated fires. I'm going to turn it on, and let's increase our maximum current first, and let's put some reasonable voltage here across the resistor. Maybe something like 3 volts. All right, so we've got 3 volts across it. Let's first measure voltage with the handheld multimeter. First, let's check to make sure we have the cables plugged in correctly. We do. Voltage, common. I'm going to turn it here to DC volts, and I'm going to put black to black, and when I touch red to red and turn on the output, I can see that we've got 2.815 volts across this resistor, and it matches very well what the machine says that it's giving to us. Let's go ahead and see what would happen if I swap red and black on the measurement side. So let's put black to red, and now I'm going to touch red to black, and you can see now I'm getting a negative number, negative 2.8 volts. Right, and that's obviously because the leads are backwards, so I've got a negative voltage drop across that resistor. Let's try the same measurement with the benchtop multimeter. Let's power it on and attach the common, and make sure that we're measuring DC volts and make sure that the cables are in the right position. And when we hook it up, we should see 2.83 volts. So again, a very accurate measure of the voltage across this resistor. Now let's measure current. All right, so I'm going to turn the output off, because to measure current, we have to insert the meter into the loop, and you can see the loop very clearly. We have current coming out of the power supply around this cable through the resistor and back through the black cable into the power supply. It's this loop that we need to break if we want to measure current. So let's first measure it with the handheld multimeter. With my voltage set at 3 and a 10 ohm resistor, if I use Ohm's law, I can calculate that 3 divided by 10 is 0.3 amperes. All right, this meter says that I can measure up to 400 milliamps before I would blow the fuse. So it's okay to leave it in this configuration, but I'm really close and I need to be careful. All right, so I'm going to hook black to black. So we have a giant loop now, and current will come out of the DC power supply through the resistor, and when I touch it, it's going to come through the red cable into the meter, measure current, go out through the meter, and back into the power supply. So measuring current is a totally different setup of the multimeter than measuring voltage. All right, now I'm going to turn on the multimeter, and let's turn it over to the milliamp range. Since we expect something on the order of about 300 milliamps or so of current flowing through this when I have it on. So let's turn it on. And right now, no current is flowing because I haven't made the connection yet. But when I take the lead here and I touch the wire, we can see that 196 milliamps are flowing through the resistor. It roughly matches here what the meter says it's providing, around 200 milliamps of current. So let's do the same measurement with the benchtop multimeter. And before we get started, we need to make sure that everything is in the right spot. So this cable needs to go to measure current. And it says here 12 amperes maximum fused. So it looks like that's the only place to measure current on this meter. So let's measure DC current, and I've got the cables properly positioned, black to black, red to red, and it's still on. And look at that. The machine says that it's supplying approximately 0.24 amperes of current, but the multimeter is telling us that it's measured 0 amperes of current. What's wrong? You see, something's wrong with this multimeter because we've got current coming out through channel one, it's going through the resistor, it's going into the meter, it's coming out of the meter, and then it's going back into the power supply. So the setup here is correct. And indeed, the DC power supply is supplying this much current, around 200 milliamps. But why does the multimeter tell us that there isn't any current being supplied? Well, the reason is that somebody's blown out the fuse. And it's very important when one of these fuses has been blown that it be replaced. Right? So this is the reason why the benchtop multimeter is giving a different reading than the handheld multimeter. If you enjoyed watching this video, then you might be interested in following our playlist and learning more about the fundamentals of electrical circuits.